In the name of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Growing up in a family of 10 children was a lot of fun, but also very stressful. Though it was fairly big house, the place always looked crowded. The month of December was busy in our household, preparing for Christmas and with the buying of new clothes for everyone. And then there was the effort to compare who got the best. In the rush of buying things, being busy with choir rehearsals, for lessons and carols, decorations, we never thought of the season we call Advent. Advent was a forgotten church season in my childhood and in my youth. I think it happens here also. We start hearing Christmas carols right after Thanksgiving. And sometimes we never think of the season called Advent. We are so totally wrapped up in thinking about Christmas, we also tend to forget the season before Christmas. The birth of a man who was in the least interested in material things has been totally filled with materialism. Looking out to see glamorous lights and hear Christmas carols, and then of course frenzied people running around shopping and trying to find the best bargain and selecting gifts for others. Sometimes we are like that lady who was having a lot of trouble during the Christmas shopping trip. As she shoved her way into the crowded elevator, she said, "I don't know who's responsible for this, but they ought to arrest him and kill him." Someone from the back of the elevator quietly said, "They already did that." It is easy to get caught up in things of Christmas. We actually miss what Christmas really is. Today I thought, during this Advent, we would think a little deeply about this precious gift God gave us 2,000 years ago. Maybe a different way of thinking will help us understand the importance of our preparation for Christmas. We may have to set aside a Christmas card understanding of Christmas and look at Bethlehem with fresh eyes. The act of God on the first Christmas day will have to be understood without romanticizing Christmas and without sanitizing the manger. So come with me to feel and witness what happened on that day. It all happened in a moment, a remarkable moment. As moments go, that one appeared no different than any other. But in reality, that particular moment was like none other. For through that segment of time, the spectacular thing happened. God became human. While creatures of the earth walked unaware, divinity arrived. Heaven opened herself and placed her most precious one in a human womb. The Omnipotent, in one instant, made himself breakable. He who had been the Spirit became pierceable. He who was larger than the universe became an embryo. And he who sustains the world with a word chose to be dependent on the nourishment of a young girl. God has fetus, holiness sleeping in the womb, the creator of life being created. God was united to us, elbows, two kidneys, and a spleen. He stretched against the walls and floated in the amniotic fluid of his mother. God has come near. He did not come as a flash of light or as an unapproachable conqueror, but as one whose first cries were heard by a peasant girl and a sleepy carpenter. The hand that first held him were unmanicured and dirty. No silk, no ivory, no honey, no hoopla. Were not for the shepherds, they would not have any reception. Were it not for a few stargazers, there would be no gifts. Can you believe this? Angels watched as Mary changed God's diaper. The universe watched in wonder as the Almighty learned how to walk. Children played in the street with him. For 33 years, he would feel everything you and I have felt. He felt weak, he grew weary, he cried, and he was afraid of failure. Well, you might say, to think of Jesus in such a light, it seems so irreverent and disrespectful. It's not something we would like to do. It is uncomfortable. It is much easier to keep the humanity out of the incarnation. It is easier for us to stomach him, some of this kind of thing, putting him as divine. There is something about keeping him divine that keeps him distant, packaged, and predictable. But for heaven's sake, do not do that. Let him be as human as he intended to be. Let him into the mire or muck of the world. For only if we let him in, he can pull us out. Listen to him. Love your neighbor was spoken by a man whose neighbors tried to kill him. Pray for those who persecute you. Came from the lips that would soon be begging God to forgive his murderers. I am with you always, are the words of a God who in one instant did the impossible to make it possible for you and me. All this happened in one moment, a remarkable moment. The world became fresh. During this Advent, we are also reminded of this truth, because this is a moment, and there will be another. The world will see another instantaneous transformation. You see, in becoming human, God made it possible for a human to see God. When Jesus left home, as one of my friends said, left the back door open. As a result, we will be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. The first moment of transformation was unnoticed by the world. But you and I are certain that the second one will not be. The next time when you use the phrase, just a moment, remember, that's all the time it will take to change the world. So how then do we prepare for Christmas? Do you want to come home for Christmas? then come home to Christ. You will remain unfulfilled and restless and homesick until God becomes your dwelling place. Saint Augustine said it so beautifully, my heart is restless until it finds its rest in you, O God. It's time to go home, right now. The good news is that we don't have to find our way home. Emmanuel has found his way to us. I'm reminded of one of my experiences in the Dominican House of Studies where I learned how to preach. We were all asked in the class, we were about 12 people, we were all asked in the class to preach a children's sermon. So when one of the students preach, all the others will have to behave like children. And the preacher will tell you what age group you belong to. So this was a sermon designed for 8 to 12. So we were all 8 to 12 people in the class. I remember this man, a very creative Catholic priest, who brought a ladder to the class. And he asked us to count the number of steps. There were 10 steps, and there was this paint stand over there. He started describing to us the 10 commandments. He talked about the first commandment, second, third, fourth, like that he went. Then he said in the end, you observe all these commandments step by step. You climb one step, second step, third step, fourth step, and finally you reach God. And the brain stand is where Mother Mary will be standing. She'll help you climb these steps. And there was a thunderous ovation for him after the class, after the sermon was preached. I was very uncomfortable. And somehow the professor noticed that and he asked me, why do you look so uncomfortable? I said, I didn't like the sermon. That was kind of rude. But I said, to be more specific, I did not like the theology. He said, why did you like it? I said, this is simply the message of Christmas. From high and above, a man came down all the 10 steps to meet me right here. And that is the gospel. I don't have to climb all the steps because he has already done it for me. And that is Christmas. The Almighty God coming down all those steps to meet us in our world and meeting us all the unlovable burdens so that they can